Honorable Thomas Hadon, the teacher for agriculture. As we added last time, look at some of the land use. Our land can be put into use in East Africa. But we could see that land can be used for cultivation, land can be used for livestock rearing, or livestock keeping, land can be used for forestry, land can be used for recreation, land can be used for fishing. Are we there? So those are some ways in which land can be put into use. Now today we are looking at some factors affecting the distribution of livestock and crops in East Africa. To interpret the question, it's like, why is that some part of the country has few animals compared to some others, to some parts of the country? Or where are some, why are some crops grown only in some areas, but not in some areas? Are we there? You find that cotton are most grown just in northern Uganda. But when you come to central, there are very few cotton grown. Are we there? You find that this coffee is abundant just in this central part, but when you go to some other part, you find that they might be not there or they might be limited. What are those factors affecting their distribution? Are we there? Okay. I think the first factor is pest, parasites, and diseases. You know, some of the animal, let us start with pests. Some of the pests, most of these pests attack crops like armyworm, like this, we call it, this one of cotton is called cotton stainer. We have these harpies. Those are some examples of pests. Then we come to parasites. We have both external and internal parasites. Well, we have ticks, we have liver fluke, we have protozoa, we have roundworm, tapeworm. To mention, how about diseases? We have both crop and animal diseases. Some of the animal diseases are rinderpest, East Coast fever, brucelloisis, trypanosomiasis, protozoa. How about crop diseases? We have this cassava brown spot. We have this, it is tomatoes brown spot. We have cassava mosaic. We have wheatgrass pest. We have maize streak. All those are crop diseases. How does this one affect the distribution of livestock and crop in East Africa? You find that in areas where there is prevalence of those serious livestock or crop diseases, very few livestock and crop will be grown in such areas. Another factor is climatic factor. Under climatic factor, we have very many that falls under climatic. That falls under climatic factor. We have rainfall, we have humidity, we have temperature. All this affects the distribution of rainfall. More especially, let me narrow it to rainfall. By the way, rainfall is a very important factor. You find that rainfall affects the fertility of the soil. Rainfall affects the fertility of the soil. Without rainfall, soil cannot be fertile. Are we there? So another factor is topography. Topography is the nature of the landscape. The topography may be hilly. The topography of an area may be flat. The topography of an area may be sloping, or a topography of an area may be gently slope. You find that this topography affects the drainage. The topography affects the draining of the area. Another factor is human activities obviously affects the distribution of crops and livestock in East Africa. You find that the population tension of land try to dictate the type of crop or animal to be reared. In most cases, you find that where there is a very high population, people tend to grow food crop compared to rearing animals and growing this cash crop. Are we there? Where there is very high population, or where their population is dense, in area which is densely populated, people tend to grow more food crop compared to cash crops and rearing animals. What are some examples of food crop? I'm talking about millet, sorghum, talk about cassava, you talk about beans, potatoes. Those are some of the food crops. Another one is epidemic factor. Epidemic means soil. Epidemic is soil. So epidemic soil can be defined as the top layer of the earth surface where crop derived nutrients and anchorage. Anchorage is like support, where plants derive nutrients and anthrate. Anthrate is support, as I told you. All soil can be defined as a mixture of weathered rock, water, living organism, hair, and which one? Humus. Are we there? All those are components of soil. How does soil affect the distribution of crops and livestock? Obviously, you know, very different parts have different soil type. You find that some parts have fertile soil and some parts have infertile clay soil. And the soil type which occurs in different parts of the country or East Africa do affect the distribution of crops and animals in East Africa. Another factor is, I could say, there are many factors that fall under the social and economic factor. A number of social and economic factors affect the distribution of livestock and crop in East Africa. The first social and economic factor is, like, you find that some communities do not produce some crops and rear some animals based on traditional and religious belief. For example, you find that Muslims do not rear pigs. That one is based on their religious belief. In most Bahima of northwestern Uganda, they rear sheep in large herd because of traditional belief. You find that the distribution of livestock and animals may also be affected by religious and traditional belief, which falls under social and economic factor. Another one, you find that Karamoja, Bahima, Turkana, they regard cattle as a source of wealth and prestige. They regard cattle as being a source of wealth and prestige. As I told you, there are some, in some other communities, even if you have wealth like water, without having cattle, then you are less regarded.
Farming system,
and the area where that farming system is practiced. Are we there? And also the type of crop which is grown under that farming system. Like for a case, we have around 7. The first one is what is called bananas coffee system. The first farming system. We call them local farming system in Uganda. The second one is called Montane system. Then the third one is called Teso system. Because when you hear of Teso system, it means it is practiced around Teso region. We have what is another system called Northern farming system. Then we have another one called banana finger millet cotton system. Bananas finger millet cotton system. That is the farming systems number 5. Then number 6 we have pastoral system. Then the final we have West Nile system. Are we there? Those are some farming systems in Uganda. We call them local farming systems in Uganda. Without wasting time, we shall go to this one called agriculture farming practices. Let us start with one which is sifting cultivation. Are we there? Sifting cultivation. You might have ever heard of sifting cultivation. Are we there? Sifting cultivation. Okay, it's where a farmer clear a piece of land. You clear a piece of land, you clear a bush, you cultivate it. You put that piece of land under continuous cultivation. Are we there? You put that piece of land under continuous cultivation. You grow sorghum, you grow some things. Let us look at some characteristics of sifting cultivation.
Result of continuous cropping. But as a farmer keeps
keeps on moving to fresh areas, it helps in controlling some crop diseases. Over there, those are some of the advantages. Another advantage is we find that there is rural independence. Then it helps in maintaining also soil fertility, since soil gets chance to regain its fertility. Over there, the fact that the farmer keeps on moving, like I cultivate here, I put that land under continuous cultivation, I move to another area, we allow this one to regain its fertility. However, I don't come back to this one, to this land. It allows this land to regain its fertility. However, it has some disadvantages, where one is, it may cause loss of soil nutrients due to this continuous farming. Of course, that's one, because that's even, it's an objective reason where a farmer, why a farmer moves to a new piece of land, because this one has lost soil fertility. That one disadvantage is that it causes a loss of soil nutrients due to burning and continuous cultivation. It is quite tiresome and it's also wasted of labor. In other words, it's limited. It is limited due to population increase. By the way, the reason as to why this shifting cultivation is not practiced nowadays because of increase in population. Because you cannot be moving from one piece of land to another, or from one place to another, yet the population is growing. Now, yet there's a lot of tension in land. So first of all, it cannot be practiced where the population is high. So it is limited where the population is high. Then there is time wasting, because after clearing this land, you grow crop, you have to move to another land, you start clearing it, you start from the first stage, have to grow in crops. So we consider it to be somehow time wasting, the shifting cultivation. Another one, the provision of extension services is difficult because the farmer has no permanent settlement, just keeps on moving. So it is quite difficult to provide extension services. I'll give you this assignment. I'll check on it when I come next time. Before we continue, the question is: you give the reason why. You give reason why the farming practice of shifting cultivation is declining in Uganda today. Okay, let us go to another farming practice, which is bush fallowing.
In arable farming, you may grow maize,
You may grow sorghum, you may grow rice, you may grow leguminous crops like ginap, like beans, like soya beans, you may grow vegetables like onions, carrots, tomatoes, etc. Some field crops like sunflower, tobacco, and cotton can also be grown under rubber farming. Okay, we have some farming practices that falls under rubber farming, like subsistence farming. Okay, you may also call it peasant farming. We call it subsistence or peasant farming. I think I've been talking about subsistence farming ever since I started the lesson. Subsistence farming is where a farmer grow crop for home consumption. Let us look at some characteristics of subsistence farming, where one, you find that labor is commonly provided by family members. In subsistence farming, you do not hire labor. It's your children, it's your relative to provide labor for subsistence farming. Another characteristic, it operates on a very small piece of land. It rarely exceeds 2 acres. Simple tools like hand hoes, like pangas, are used in this subsistence farming. What would be another characteristic of subsistence farming? We find that limited farm inputs. When we talk of farm inputs, like fertilizers, like chemicals are used. There are less used of chemicals like fertilizers and under subsistence farming. Intercropping is normally done. Intercropping is where you grow some crops. Okay, you grow more than one type of crop in the garden. Are we there? Come on.
Stop here, then we shall continue next time.
But before, I think I should have, I have to give you this question, this some bit of assignment. There are now two. The question is, why is subsistence farming commonly practiced in Uganda? Why do you see in this commercial farming, where the farmer grow on, crop only for own consumption, is widely practiced in Uganda? That is a question. Next time when we come, we shall look at mixed farming, but we shall start from mixed farming and so on. I thank you for your attention. We shall start from there next time.